We find a seminar from Alexander Bibright. Alexander has graduated from the Santa Cruz State University from Brazil to doctorate in biomedicine, and he moved to the US to join our lab in 2009. Since then, in the last 5 years, he's scored several goals in the games of the time. So he would nine goals in total, so he assists, and he has two papers under review, so probably he's going to complete his experience with us in publishing around 12 pages, something that is really amazing. So his work is based on a lot of criticism. It's a very hard topic, but it's also under debate in many areas. So that's why I really encourage you, especially those that are not in the committee, to make questions. So because that's going to help him, because pesticides are in the vasculature in every tissue, and therefore they may influence not only the biology of the tissue, not only the capacity of the tissue to be repaired, but it also will influence all the stem cells, because pesticides form the niche for stem cells in many organs. So, with nothing else to say, I ask Alexander to go ahead and present his thesis, and then after this we're gonna move to another room. I'm gonna discuss with the members of the committee specifics about the content of his his thesis. The title is precise at the intersection between tissue regeneration and pathology.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you. Good morning, everybody. Thanks a lot, everybody, for being here today. So the title of my talk will be Pericytes at the intersection between tissue regeneration and pathology. It is widely accepted that tissue regeneration depends on stem cells. However, under certain pathological conditions, those cells may form some unwanted tissues, such as fibrous and adipose tissue, which impair organ function. What we found here is that sometimes the pericytes that form those undesired tissues differ from the ones that participate in tissue regeneration. So initially, I will introduce to you the concept of pericytes functioning as stem cells. Every tissue has its own committed stem cells, which are restricted to form cells of this specific tissue. This is, for instance, happening in the central nervous system with the neural stem cell, in the skin with the sphincter, in the muscle with the satellite cells. There are also other stem cells that are not tissue restricted, the mesenchymal stem cells. They are multipotent, being able to form a variety of tissues. They contribute to tissue cell turnover and respond to damage. Their precise locations are unclear, and they are present in small numbers. Because of their low distribution in all organs, it has been proposed that maybe they can have a common origin. As blood vessels are also present in almost every tissue in the body, cells associated with the blood vessels, called pericytes, have been proposed to be mesenchymal stem cells. Pericytes are characterized by their anatomical location. They are in a very close proximity to blood vessel endothelial cells. Their main function is related with vascular stability. So in this image, by analogy, this will be the pericytes which stabilize the vessels. They have multiple other functions. Here we will focus specifically on their function as multipotent stem cells. Pericytes can form muscle, cartilage, adipose tissue, and bone. And now I will show you that in skeletal muscle cultures, pericytes can form neural progenitors. In our recent work, we isolated neural progenitors from skeletal muscle cultures. For this, we used a transgenic mice that is called nesting GFP, in which the GFP fluorescence is under control of nesting regulatory elements. Nestin is a cytoskeletal protein which is a marker of multiple stem cells, including neural stem cells. When we extract the muscles from those animals and culture them under optimized culture conditions, after 10 days, all the cells that express Nestin GFP fluorescence also co-express multiple neural progenitor markers, for instance, TUJ1. Those cells also have neural morphology. As neural progenitors are known to respond to neurotransmitters, we tested whether those cells could respond to neurotransmitters. So we did whole cell voltage clamping those cells and exposed them to short pulses of glutamate. And we observed that the cells responded with typical inward currents, while when we exposed those cells for a little bit longer to glutamate, in this case for 1 second, those cells stopped responding, as some of the glutamate receptors have the characteristic to desensitize when exposed for a longer time to the agonist. In addition, we injected those cells in the brain striatum, as shown here in the green dot. Those cells survived and migrated to the subventricular zone, which is a very special area located around the lateral ventricle, which is the natural neurogenic area where the endogenous neural stem cells are located. Those cells were very similar to a specific type of neural progenitors, which are called NG2 glia cells, as by immunocytochemistry they expressed multiple markers of those cells, like oligodendrocyte progenitor marker 4, platelet derived growth factor receptor alpha, nerve growth factor receptor, and the glutamate receptor AMPA. Notice that this result is in agreement with our electrophysiological data, as the glutamate receptor AMPA has the characteristic to desensitize when exposed for a longer time to glutamate. Those cells have outward potassium currents and express the potassium channels KIR6.1, specific of NG2 glia cells. When we culture those cells in dishes uncoated, they form these floating neurospheres, which when seeded into dishes pre-coated with laminin, attach, forming those monolayers in which the cells make contact between them, which are additional characteristics of neural progenitors. So based on our findings, we hypothesized that we can collect a skeletal muscle biopsy, culture the cells under optimized culture conditions, and by sorting based on surface markers, we could isolate pure neural progenitors, which could be used for cell therapy approaches, what we are currently testing in our lab. However, those neural progenitors, they are not present in the intact skeletal muscle as such. They are formed after culture. So our next question was, what cells in the skeletal muscle have the potential to originate those neural progenitors after culture? As in the central nervous system, pericytes can be induced to differentiate into the neural lineage, we hypothesize that pericytes from the skeletal muscle also could have this potential. So then, we cross our Nestin GFP mice with NG2DS red mice, in which all the pericytes which express NG2 proteoglycan are marked by DS red fluorescence. Then, by immunohistochemistry, we analyze the skeletal muscle of the double transgenic animals obtained. So, in the skeletal muscles of those mice, we found two different populations of NG2DS-RED positive cells. Some cells that do not express Nestin GFP fluorescence, but also express some other pericytic markers, as platelet-derived growth factor receptor beta and CD146. And another population of NG2DS-RED positive cells that do express Nestin GFP fluorescence and also express the other pericytic markers. Confirming their pericytic nature, we found that both cell populations are located in a very close proximity to CD31 blood vessel endothelial cells. So in summary, we found two different pericytic subtypes in the skeletal muscle. We call type 1 pericytes from now on the ones that do not express Nestin GFP fluorescence, while we call type 2 pericytes the ones that express Nestin GFP fluorescence. Next, from the skeletal muscle of those double transgenic mice, we isolated by sorting based on GFP and DS-RED fluorescence 4 different cell populations, encountered them separately for 10 days. After this time, we found that no of this cell population formed nesting GFP-positive neural progenitors in our culture conditions. Then we hypothesized that probably the cell population in those skeletal muscle cultures that may originate neural progenitors need some secreted factors or contacts from the other cells present in those skeletal muscle cultures. To address this point, we co-cultured again each of these cell populations from the transgenic mice together with a whole skeletal muscle culture from wild-type animals. And we found that only one of these cell populations can form nesting GFP-positive neural progenitors after 10 days. That was the cell population that expressed nesting NNG2 that corresponded to type 2 pericytes, indicating that in the skeletal muscle, only type 2 pericytes have the potential to form those neural progenitors in our culture conditions. When we culture the pericyte subpopulations in a medium without any special supplements, both pericyte subtypes become small muscle cells, the reported fate of pericytes in culture. In summary, the skeletal muscle has multiple cell types. Here we outline three of those types. In red are the satellite cells, the muscle-specific stem cells. And in yellow and green are type 1 and type 2 pericytes. The satellite cells are committed to the myogenesis, while type 2 pericytes in green, they are the ones that express nesting GFP fluorescence, and under optimized culture conditions, they may form those neural progenitors. While type 1 pericytes in yellow do not express nesting GFP, and under the same culture conditions, they only form smooth muscle cells. Our results suggest that the two pericyte subtypes in the skeletal muscle differ in their differentiation potential, as pericytes have been shown to participate also in skeletal muscle regeneration. Our next question was whether the role of pericyte subtypes differ also in skeletal muscle regeneration. So in the next part of the talk, I will be speaking to you about the role of the pericyte subpopulations in skeletal muscle regeneration. In the diseased skeletal muscle, fibrous and adipose tissue accumulate, affecting skeletal muscle function and its regenerative capacity. So for instance, this is a slice from a patient with muscular dystrophy. Most of the skeletal muscle is replaced by fat tissue shown here in white. This has been associated with changes in stem cell function. The most well-studied stem cells in the skeletal muscle are the satellite cells, which are located beneath the basal lamina of the muscle fibers, and they are committed to the muscle lineage. Besides satellite cells, there are multiple other cell types in the skeletal muscle. For instance, fibroblasts, pericytes and endothelial cells around the blood vessels, adipocytes, Schwann cells at the nerve terminals. While pericytes are multipotent, satellite cells are restricted to the myogenic lineage and cannot form other cell types. So here we hypothesize that the pericyte subpopulations play an important and distinctive role in skeletal muscle regeneration, and our preliminary results suggested that while one pericyte subtype is adipogenic and fibrogenic, the other was myogenic and vasculogenic, and our aim was to establish the regenerative capacity of the pericyte subpopulations. So initially, from the skeletal muscle of those double transgenic mice, by sorting, we isolated the type 1 and type 2 pericytes. Type 1 pericytes, remember, the ones that do not express nesting GFP, but do express NG2 DSRED and other pericytic markers. While type 2 pericytes, the ones that express both nesting GFP and NG2 DSRED, and express other pericytic markers as well. And we found that under culture in myogenic conditions, only type 2 pericytes were able to form myotubes, these multinucleated muscle cells which stay positive to myosin heavy chain. While under adipogenic conditions, only type 1 pericytes form adipocytes, which stain positive to pyrrolidine, that is a protein coating lipid droplets in fat cells. When we culture type 1 and type 2 pericytes under fibrogenic conditions, only type 1 pericytes start expressing the fibroblast marker FSP1 in vitro, and also they produce type 1 collagen, suggesting that in summary, in vitro, type 1 pericytes, the ones that do not express MSTGFP fluorescence, are adipogenic and fibrogenic, while type 2 pericytes, the ones that express MSTGFP, are migraine. Now, how to track the fate of type 1 and type 2 pericytes in vivo? To address this point, we made use of beta-axin DSRF mice, which we crossed with our MSTGFP mice, and in the double transgenic mice, obtained all the cells at DSRF fluorescence. Then we isolated the pericyte subpopulations from the skeletal muscle of those double transgenic mice by sorting using MG2APC antibody. And now remember, both type 1 and type 2 pericytes have DSRF fluorescence, enabling us to track their fate even after injection into another animal. To study fat formation in the skeletal muscle, we used a classical model of adipose tissue accumulation in the muscle induced by glycerol injection. Then we transplanted either type 1 or type 2 DSRF positive pericytes, and after 2 weeks, we removed the muscles from those animals for analysis. In the muscles that were injected with type 1 pericytes, we found that perilipin positive cells also express DSRF fluorescence, meaning that type 1 pericytes can start expressing perilipin also in vivo. While in the muscles that were injected with type 2 pericytes, we didn't detect any overlap of perilipin with DSRF fluorescence, indicating that only type 1 pericytes are adipogenic also in vivo. Next, to study normal muscle formation after injury, we transplanted either type 1 or type 2 DSRF positive pericytes into a classical mouse model of muscle injury induced by barium chloride. And after 2 weeks, we found that only muscles that were injected with type 2 pericytes had those DSRF positive myofibers. We confirmed our findings in sections of those muscles. And we can see here that while type 1 pericytes remain in the interstitial space of the skeletal muscle, type 2 pericytes were able to form DSRF positive myofibers with central nucleus, suggesting that only type 2 pericytes are myogenic also in vivo. So in summary, type 2 pericytes may contribute to the muscle formation after injury in the healthy skeletal muscle, while type 1 pericytes may contribute to the adipose tissue accumulation that is happening in the diseased skeletal muscle, as for instance in muscular dystrophy, when most of the skeletal muscle is replaced by fat tissue. So it is well known that aging may affect the tissue microenvironment, and specifically in the skeletal muscle after injury, fibrous tissue is formed instead of muscle. So our next question was whether the myogenic potential of type 2 pericytes can be affected by the aging microenvironment. To address this point, we injected the same number of type 2 pericytes with DSRF fluorescence into injured skeletal muscles of young, middle-aged, and old mice. And after 2 weeks, we found that the number of DSRF positive myofibers derived from type 2 pericytes decreased in the old mice. And also the cross-sectional area of those myofibers derived from DSRF positive type 2 pericytes as well decreased with age, suggesting that the microenvironment may affect the myogenic potential of type 2 pericytes. In addition, we injected type 1 pericytes with DSRF fluorescence into injured skeletal muscles of old mice. And we found that differently than type 2 pericytes, after 2 weeks, type 1 pericytes didn't form DSRF positive myofibers. Instead, they remained in the interstitial space of the skeletal muscle, producing type 1 collagen, and also they expressed the fibroblast marker FSP1, indicating that only type 1 pericytes are fibrogenic in the old muscle in vivo. So in summary, in the healthy skeletal muscle after injury, type 2 pericytes, together with satellite cells, they contribute to the muscle formation. While in the old skeletal muscle after injury, type 2 pericytes also may contribute to muscle formation. However, those muscle fibers are smaller and fewer, While type 1 pericytes contribute to the fibrous tissue formation that is happening in the old skeletal muscle after injury. Now, in the next part of the talk, I will be speaking to you about some additional roles that we found in pericyte subtypes, as for instance, in fibrosis in other tissues. So first, we administer the fibrogen agent bleomycin in the lungs of nesting GFPs to the acetylcholine channels. And after 2 weeks, this results in lung fibrosis. In those mice, we found that the number of type 1 pericytes increased significantly. They corresponded to approximately 15% of the collagen-producing cells, while type 2 pericytes didn't generate any detectable collagen, suggesting that type 1 pericytes accumulate at the injury site after lung injury and contribute to pulmonary fibrosis. Next, we induced unilateral urethral obstruction in STGF-finity to the acetylgenic mice, and after 2 weeks, this generates renal fibrosis. In those mice also, we found that the number of type 1 pericytes increased significantly after renal injury, while type 2 pericytes did not. Also, we detected a high concentration of those type 1 pericytes near areas dense in collagen accumulation. However, those type 1 pericytes were not producing any type 1 collagen, suggesting that type 1 pericytes do not contribute to kidney fibrosis. To verify whether pericytes participate in the fibrosis formation after myocardial injury, we induced infarct in nesting GFPs to the acetylgenic mice by ligating the lateral anterior descending coronary artery, what resulted after 2 weeks in myocardium with dense scar tissue accumulation. In those mice, we found that the number of type 1 pericytes increased significantly at the infarcted area. However, they did not produce type 1 collagen, which also accumulated in the same infarcted area, suggesting that type 1 pericytes are recruited to the infarcted location after myocardial injury, but they do not contribute to tissue fibrosis. To verify whether pericytes can participate in the scar formation after spinal cord injury, we performed a cut in the dorsal funiculus of nesting GFPNG to the acetylgenic mice, and after 2 weeks, we found the type 1 pericytes, the ones that express NG to the acetyl, but do not express nesting GFP fluorescence, they increase significantly at the local where the scar is formed after spinal cord injury, while the cells that are positive for NG2 and NES is distributed throughout the spinal cord section. In addition, we performed a similar injury in one of the sides of the brain of the nesting GFP NG2 the acetylgenic mice. And after 2 weeks, we found that in the injured side of the brain, in the scar tissue, type 1 pericytes accumulated in comparison with the contralateral uninjured side of the brain. However, those NG2DSR-positive pericytes didn't overlap with PDGFR-beta-positive cells, as PDGFR-beta is a marker of several other cell types, such as fibroblasts. Our results suggest that PDGFR-beta-positive cells, which are functionally contributing to central nervous system fibrosis, differ from the NG2DSR-positive pericytes in the central nervous system. So in summary, our results suggest that type 1 pericytes accumulate after tissue injury. However, they only produce collagen in an organ-dependent manner. Now, I will speak to you about the roles of pericyte subtypes in angiogenesis, vessel formation. Both endothelial cells and pericytes are needed for vessel formation. So our next question was whether both pericyte subtypes are angiogenic. To test their angiogenic capacity in vitro, we made use of human umbilical vein endothelial cells, which we co-cultured together with isolated either type 1 or type 2 DSR-positive pericytes. After co-culture with type 1 pericytes, we didn't detect any vessel formation. While when co-culture with type 2 pericytes, we found structures very similar to blood vessels in vitro, suggesting that only like trigericides, surprisingly, are angiogenic in vitro. To confirm their angiogenic potential also in vivo, we added to the mixture of pubic cells used in the type 1 or type 2 DSF positive pericytes, matrigel, which induces vessel formation. And then we injected all this mixture subcutaneously into nude mice, and we recovered the matrigel plaques for analysis after 2 weeks. We found that while in the plaques that were injected with type 1 pericytes, we didn't detect any vessels, in the plaques that were injected with type 2 pericytes, now they were vascularized. And in addition, we detected beta arcs in DSF fluorescence around the blood vessels in the plaques that were injected with type 2 pericytes, indicating that only type 2 pericytes are angiogenic also in vivo. The tumors, when they grow, they form new blood vessels, which recruit cells from the host. So as forming new blood vessels is the process that is called angiogenesis, our next question was whether both pericyte subtypes are recruited during tumor angiogenesis. To address this point, we injected tumor cells from glioblastoma into the brains of nesting GFP-22 DSF transgenic mice. And after 36 days, we removed the brains for analysis. Here I'm showing you a section of one of those brains. These lines separate the normal brain tissue from the tumoral tissue. So in the normal brain, we found two different types of NG2DSR-positive cells, as shown in the red box, cells that express NG2DSR fluorescent but do not express NSTGFP. While in the yellow box, in the normal brain tissue, we found also cells that express NG2DSR fluorescence and NSTGFP fluorescence. While invading the tumors, as shown, for instance, in the white box, we only found cells that express both NG2DSR and NSTGFP. However, in the central nervous system, besides type 2 pericytes, oligodendrocyte progenitors also express NG2DSR and NSTGFP. As oligodendrocyte progenitors are not present in the periphery, we injected tumor cells subcutaneously into NSTGFP and NG2DSR transgenic mice. And approximately after 2 weeks, we removed the tumoral tissue together with its surrounding normal tissue for analysis. And by immunohistochemistry, we can see here that in the normal tissue, in this case skeletal muscle, we found two different types of pericytes. Type 1 pericytes that express NG2DSR fluorescence do not express NSTGFP fluorescence and are located very close to CD31 blood vessel endothelial cells. And in the yellow box, we also found type 2 pericytes that express both NG2DSR and NSTGFP and also are located close to blood vessel endothelial cells. While in the tumoral blood vessels, marked here with CD31, we only detected type 2 pericytes, indicating that only type 2 pericytes are recruited during tumor angiogenesis. Now, could be the type 2 pericytes also be used for therapeutic angiogenesis? The stimulation of angiogenesis may improve the blood perfusion and the function in ischemic tissues. For instance, a condition called critical limb ischemia is caused by blood vessel obstruction and constriction, which may lead to limb necrosis and even amputation in some cases. So we used a mouse model of this condition, critical limb ischemia, in which we ligate and cut the femoral artery in those mice, what stops the blood flow in those limbs, making the limbs ischemic. Then we analyze those animals by MRI angiography. We can see that in the contralateral unaffected limb, we can detect blood flow in the femoral artery, while in the ischemic limb, this blood flow disappears. Then we injected either type 1 or type 2 DSR positive pericytes. And after 2 weeks, we analyzed by the same technique again the limbs of those animals. We found that while type 1 pericytes were unable to recover the blood flow in this artery, type 2 pericytes recover the blood flow in the femoral artery after 2 weeks. Now I will show you the same results in three-dimensional images of the limbs of those animals below the knee. So we can see that while type 1 pericyte didn't recover the blood flow in the femoral artery, type 2 pericyte were able to partially recover the blood flow in this artery. In addition, by immunohistochemistry, we detected the type 2 pericytes surrounding the newly formed blood vessels in the limbs of those animals injected with type 2 pericytes, indicating that type 2 pericytes will be used also for therapeutic angiogenesis. Now, in a general summary of our story, the pericytes as a whole population, they are multipotent. What we found here is that pericytes are heterogeneous, and there is at least two pericyte subpopulations, which are oligopotent. They are more lineage-restricted. While type 1 pericytes made for fat and fibrous tissue, type 2 pericytes made for muscle, neural cells, and blood vessels. In conclusion, while one pericyte subtypes favor vasculogenesis and myogenesis, the other counterbalances these positive outcomes by forming fibrous and adipose tissue. Also, we have shown that type 1 pericyte participation in fibrosis is tissue dependent. And also, we demonstrate that only type 2 pericytes are recruited during tumor angiogenesis. Finally, our model provides central cellular targets susceptible in the future to signaling manipulation and pharmacological manipulation. And with this, I would like to thank several people without which nothing of this work will be done. So all this I will read because I didn't memorize. So all this will not be done without multiple people. So first of all, I need to thank a lot. I would like to especially thank my mentor, Dr. Osvaldo Del Bono. I was very lucky to have such a mentor for guiding me throughout this PhD, being supportive, approachable, and always motivating me. Also, I would like to thank all Del Bono Lab. I was very lucky to be part of this wonderful group. I would like to thank the past members, as for instance Jackson, and all the current members, Laura, Tan, Somit, and Andrea. Especially I would like to thank Laura for being so supportive and patient with me. I would like to thank my co-mentor, Dr. Akiva Mintz, and his lab. He always supported me strongly and always offered helpful advice. I would like to thank all our collaborators and all the thesis committee for their time and their strong support. I would like to thank the Rabbi Plotkin and his family. In these more than 5 years, they have been my second family. And I would like to thank everybody that came today, and in special my friend Jimmy that came all the way from Brazil. And also I would like to thank my future wife, Veronica, always strongly supporting me. Thank you, and I will be happy to take any questions.
Thank
you.
Sure. Yeah.
Very, very nice girl. In your muscle injury model, you are suggesting that the type 2 pericytes can turn into myofibers. How would you confirm that they
were myofibers? Okay, so let me check if I understood right the question. So your question is whether the type 2 pericytes, how can we confirm that they form muscle fibers in our muscle injury model? So what we did is that we isolated those pericytes from mice that all the cells of those mice express DSRF fluorescence. Right. So as well, when we isolate type 1 and type 2 pericytes, they will have DSRF fluorescence throughout all their life. So even when we injected them into the injury mouse model of a wild-type animal, all the DSRF positive cells after injury will be derived from the cells that we injected. As the normal wild-type mice, they don't express DSRF fluorescence. So as we can see, after injection of type 2 pericytes, we can see DSRF positive myofibers, but we cannot see DSRF positive myofibers when we inject multiple other cell types, as for instance type 1 pericytes. We suggest that they are.
Yeah, but how do you know they're myofibers? Did you do an immuno specific inner stain?
We didn't. So we did a myosin heavy chain stain that is specific of myofibers. This is first of all. And second of all, myofibers are multinucleated cells. So if we see a cell that has multiple nucleus, the only cell in the skeletal muscle are myofibers. So it was okay. Yes. Thank you. But you said you asked a lot of questions.
Have you heard of the tech process in the model of two type of tool in human artificial type?
Yes, okay, so let me see if I understood right. The question is whether type 1 pericytes and type 2 pericytes exist in the human skeletal muscles. I have two answers to your question, but they will both answer. So, in my opinion,